throws to Sweeney. He leaps, catches, touchdown, California!
It looks good.
And it was in the Pacific Age. Saturday afternoons filled with excitement, thrills, the color, and the pageantry of college football. Nearly 2 million spectators on the West Coast see some of the game's finest moments in college football's 102nd season. It's all a big part of Pacific 8 Football 1971. Washington State's scrambling Cougars compiled their best record since 1965, including the sweetest triumph ever, a 24-23 last-second win over Rose Bowl-bound Stanford for coach Jim Sweeney. The Cougars featured a wide-open offensive attack built around junior quarterback Ty Payne, number 14, and running back ace Bernard Jackson, number 26, storming the Pacific 8 scene with some brilliant open-field running. The Washington State defense, with all-conference cornerback Ron Mims leading the way, provided Cougar fans with some sparkling performances. But it was Jackson who made good things happen for the Cougars. He proved that point in Spokane with his brilliant 100-yard kickoff return. A bevy of talented Cougar rushers, Jackson, number 32, Ken Liday, and junior fullback Ken Granberry made WSU the number one rushing team in the Pacific 8, averaging nearly 240 rushing yards per game during the season. Granberry, number 44, was the Cougars' second leading rusher behind Jackson, starting the attack against the USC Trojans. WSU's defense proved a stubborn foe for the potent Troy offense. And of course, Jackson wasn't easy for that Trojan defense to stop either. Nor was Payne, who turned in some nifty running himself. Against cross-state rival Washington, Payne and Jackson hooked up for some brilliant offensive moves that kept the Cougars in the thick of the battle, though they came into the rival clash as heavy underdogs. Washington State power smashes up the middle moved behind a highly regarded Cougar line, spearheaded by Jim Giese, Buzz Brazo, and all-conference guard Steve Bush. Sweeney always has a few plays up his sleeve, and the razzle-dazzle unfolded before the Huskies in Seattle. This reverse lateral to Payne and pass to junior Herb Alexander set up a touchdown flip by Payne to sophomore Bob Redman in heavy Husky traffic, capping one of Washington State's most exciting seasons in more than a decade. Rated a contender for the Pac-8 title, USC, with scrambling quarterback Jim Jones opening his third season, the Trojans running into a stubborn Stanford defense in a crucial battle has a major bearing on the race to the Rose Bowl. USC has trouble getting its offense going. When they do it in great fashion with this pass from Mike Ray to Odessa Garrison for 46 yards. The Trojan defense, behind the superb play of a pair of all-conference performers, Willie Hall and John Grant, turned in a great third quarter against Stanford, shutting out the Indians. USC displayed plenty of talented juniors, like Charles Hinton, number 26. Sam Cunningham, number 39. And tight end Charles Young, number 89. Coming off a 28-14 triumph over nationally ranked Notre Dame at South Bend, the Trojans took on California's stubborn Bears in Berkeley and never looked better. Jones builds the lead to 14-0 with this toss to sophomore Lynn Swan.
Hall
Hall, Grant, and the rest of the USC defense demolished Cal's offense. And head coach John McKay's vow to strengthen his defense is never more evident as junior Bruce Dyer picks off a deflected pass. The USC offense goes back onto the attack, with Jones running the show and hitting Garrison on the sideline. Junior Sam Cunningham flies over the top for more Trojan yardage. And Mike Ray closes out one of USC's finest performances of the season with a 13-yard scoring toss to Swan. That sets the stage for USC's classic national television game with UCLA in the Los Angeles Coliseum. And the Trojan defense is ready for the challenge. Sophomore running back Manfred Moore provides the early offensive punch for USC when he bursts through All-America John Bella's hole at left tackle and romps 57 yards. Swift Lou Harris then going over the top to put the Trojans in the lead 7-0. Junior Mike McGurr, 74, and Hall, 83, spearhead a defense that punishes the UCLA running game. The Trojans have to settle for a 7-7 tie, but outstanding play by the USC junior and sophomore brigade shows plenty of promise for the Trojans to be a top contender in 72. Oregon State displays its usual power, full house tee offense, but with a new wrinkle. Elusive quarterback Steve Endicott adding a new dimension to the game as he returns following a shoulder injury, which sidelined him during the 1976. An aggressive Beaver defense led by all-conference Steve Brown and Jim Sherbert sets up another opportunity for kicker Lynn Boston, who made good on 8 of 14 from the year. But it was a rugged defense. And a powerful running game that gained a second place finish for Oregon State in the conference race. The OSU defense had some bright moments against Washington. The biggest play came when the Beavers stormed quarterback Sonny Sixkiller and blitzing Beaver linebacker Butch Wicks picked off a fumble in midair, going 58 yards for an OSU score in the first quarter. Endicott, who ranked fourth among Pac-8 passers, hooked up with his favorite receiver, number 81, Jeff Colbert. And Bill Carlquist picked up some hard-earned ground yardage to add to the offensive armada. In the dark shadows of Husky Stadium, backup quarterback Jim Kilmartin shows his elusiveness. The wildest offensive battle of the year for the Beavers came on the final weekend of the season against arch-rival Oregon. Number 25, Mike Maestri, a junior, and hard-charging fullback Dave Schilling fire up OSU's power offense. An alert defense stalls Oregon advances. While Maestri threads his way through the pesky duck defense. Coach D. Andros' full house backfield smashes into the Oregon trenches. It pays off with Endicott's masterful faking for a wild 30-29 victory over the rival Ducks. Ineligible to play in the Rose Bowl, California's Bears still set an early exciting pace as they open their Pacific 8 season with a thrilling last-second victory over Oregon State. Isaac Curtis gets the Bears going in their first series, first for 17 yards, and then all the way for 13 yards in a 7-0 California lead. Just as vital an asset against the Beavers is a rugged California defense. Curtis is not the only offensive weapon the Bears throw at OSU. Junior Steve Chemnitzer bursts on the scene as Cal's leading rusher and sets the stage for a 29-yard field goal from the toe of junior Ray Wershing. The Bear offense wastes little time in going to work again as Jay Cruz fires to wide receiver Jeff DeLapp for a 66-yard touchdown en route to a 30-27 Cal victory. Later in the season, California's defense relentlessly battles USC's Trojans. Curtis proves why he was among the conference leaders in kickoff returns with this weaving jaunt upfield. Cruz provides California with a balanced offense with his passing to Chemnitzer and to senior Tim Todd, number 22, adding valuable yardage with some nifty running. The Cal offense runs into a determined Rose Bowl-bound Stanford defense in the 74th traditional big game at Stanford Stadium. But the California defense was just as fired up against the potent Indian attack, especially All-American tackle Sherm White and All-Conference cornerback Ray Youngblood. The Bears found themselves working out of their own territory, but plays like this pass from Cruz to All-Conference flanker Steve Sweeney kept the battle close, Stanford finally pulling out a hard-earned 14-0 triumph. UCLA's new head coach Pepper Rogers moves junior Scott Henderson into the starting lineup to run a newly installed wishbone offense. Henderson picking out a favorite target, All-Conference tight end Bob Christensen. There's an abundance of running backs for the Bruins to use, including number 31 junior Gary Campbell, scoring against Washington State. Henderson proved a capable ball handler and runner too against the Cougars, using senior fullback Marv Kendricks to polish off a scoring drive. The Bruin defense sparks with an interception by linebacker Bob Piferini to help the cause. And Campbell piles off right tackle to make way for accurate sophomore field goal kicker Efren Herrera. Henderson and junior Randy Tyler team for a big afternoon as the Bruins took on Washington in a key Pacific 8 clash several weeks later. The Bruin offense was somewhat stymied by the rugged Husky defense, so Herrera got in plenty of field goal kicking. The Bruin defense turned in one of its better performances, as did Tyler, the junior running back who had his best day of the season with 102 yards rushing. Herrera was a busy Bruin. He kicked four field goals, including this one, from 48 yards out. The UCLA defense set up another score late in the game when they stormed Husky quarterback Sonny Sixkiller. Workhorse Tyler rambling, but the UCLA scoring belongs to Herrera, and he scores another 3 points from 43 yards out. Defense was the name of the game when the Bruins closed out the season against cross-city rival USC. The Bruins' stop team was never better in halting threatening drives by the Trojans. Sophomore defensive end Fred McNeil puts the pressure on the USC punter, and the Bruins get their first big break of the nationally televised battle. It starts with a fine run by Marv Kendricks, then Gary Campbell. And finally by Kendricks behind the blocking of two-time All-Conference center Dave Dalby, ending the season with a 7-7 tie against USC. No team had a tougher schedule to start with in 71 than Oregon, and the emphasis in the early going was on the defense, as the Ducks had to play Nebraska, Stanford, Texas, USC, and Washington in five of their first six games, while All-Conference defensive back Bill Drake, number 38, was raising havoc with Stanford's offense in the Pac-8 opener. Junior quarterback Dan Fouts was called on to provide the big push in the Oregon offense, getting things started with this pass to junior receiver Leland Glass. Sophomore fullback Greg Hurd provided the brawn and the power in the running game, and exciting Bobby Moore, number 23, the speed. Fouts engineered the first Oregon score late in the first half against Stanford, zeroing in with a TD toss to junior Greg Specht. The Oregon defense, toughened in the second half against the Indians and the alert Drake, put the Ducks back in the battle with his steal and brilliant return. Drake worked better than a pickpocket in the Oregon secondary, tying as the conference leader in interceptions with 7 steals, this one coming in Oregon's narrow victory over Washington. Bobby Moore set all kinds of Oregon rushing records during the season, en route to finishing as the Pac-8 top rusher with 1,211 yards. Larry Battle contributed 2 key plays in the win over the Huskies, first with a 25-yard field goal, and second with a leaping catch of a 19-yard Fouts aerial that sparked a key scoring drive. Moore added to the march with this burst, and then Fouts hit Leland Glass for 19 more yards, and the power-driving herd plowed his way into the end zone for the score. The Duck defense gained the first big break in the traditional against Oregon State. Then they forced this hurried punt that brings Mr. Drake back on the scene. Drake scooping up the ball and returning it for an Oregon touchdown. Fouts hooked up time and again with his junior teammate, Glass, who ranked second among conference receivers with 46 catches. The Oregon line, anchored by all-conference seniors John McKean and Tom Drugas, provided the Oregon quarterback with superb protection. Washington's Huskies opened the season as a bona fide Rose Bowl contender looking for a running game. Complement the superb passing of quarterback Sonny Sixkiller. The Husky defense was much improved too and finished as the second best in the Pac-8 behind champion Stanford. Part of the running game blossomed in the Oregon battle with sophomore Pete Tagaris driving up the middle for a Washington touchdown, much to the delight of head coach Jim Owens. Sixkiller was the man who moved the Husky offense along with a sensational receiver, junior Tom Scott, whose catch sets up a touchdown run by sophomore Jim Eicher. One of Washington's finest games of the season came against Oregon State, where Scott, number 26, was employed as a running back and a receiver. The Husky offense was never better in grinding out an impressive 38-14 win, as Sixkiller ran and passed his way to victory before more than 60,000 spectators in Seattle. The Washington offense continued to roll in brilliant fashion the next weekend against UCLA, with Scott again used as a running back. Sixkiller also made use of the all-conference performer in the air game with this perfect 50-yard scoring bomb. The Washington defense did another top job, and started another scoring march with this interception by cornerback Larry Worley. Sixkiller had a fantastic afternoon, passing for 206 yards, including 2 touchdown tosses to Scott, his favorite target all season. Sonny, the passer, turned into a fleet-footed runner in the cross-state showdown with Washington State. He capped the first Husky series with this 32-yard scamper. Spurred on by the rugged Washington defense, headed by a pair of Fall Conference juniors, tackle Gordy Gwynn and cornerback Cal Jones, the Huskies put together an impressive 28-20 victory, the third win in a row for Owens and his Huskies over the Cougars in this 64-year-old series. With the pressure on defending champion Stanford, Jackie Brown powers the way on the ground, and quarterback Don Bunce hits through the air to get the Indian Rose Bowl Express off to a fast start against Oregon in the conference opener. A big catch by sophomore John Winesbury, and some great runs by Brown. And junior fullback Reggie Sanderson notch a 38-17 triumph. The Indian defense torments Washington's vaunted passing game in the next key game in the race to the Roses. Bunce and company convincingly shattered the Husky Rose Bowl hopes. Bunce combining with the defense and engineering the Stanford team to perfection. The Thunder Chickens, Stanford's awesome front four, pressured the Huskies, and the secondary erased nearly every scoring opportunity for a 17-6 victory. The third critical battle was the showdown with USC, and Brown provided the initial momentum for this classic rematch. Bunce capped the Indians' first series on a sweep for 6 points. The defense blanked the Trojans for 3 quarters. And a partisan USC crowd in the Coliseum watched Bunce run the option with precision in the fourth quarter, pitching to Reggie Sanderson for an 80-yard scoring play that highlighted a 33-18 triumph. The Thunder Chickens, with All-American linebacker Jeff Seaman and All-League linemen Pete Lazaric and Larry Butler, were at their best against California in the big game. Bunce gets the offense rolling with a 58-yard strike to Brown, as the Indians finish the season with a 14-0 victory and a 5-1 conference record that sends them into the Rose Bowl for the second straight year. It was the first Rose Bowl game for the two new commissioners of the great conferences competing in this granddaddy of all the bowls. Wayne Duke, the new commissioner of the Big Ten Conference, and Wiles Halleck, the new executive director of the Pacific Eight Conference. Halleck describes the feeling of entering his first Rose Bowl.
I don't know that there's any greater thrill that a person in intercollegiate athletics could have than standing on the turf of the Rose Bowl, the greatest of all bowl games, and anticipating his first bowl game as a member of the athletic community that participates in this game.
Oh, you're absolutely right, Wiles. This, often called, of course, very trite as it might sound, the granddaddy of them all, but it certainly is. The history, the tradition, the great spectacle of intercollegiate athletics is certainly unfolded right here.
103,000 spectators are on hand New Year's Day 1972 to watch Stanford's Indians take on undefeated Big Ten champion Michigan in the 58th Rose Bowl Classic. The defending Rose Bowl champion Indians are decided underdogs against a Michigan team that's defeated 11 opponents with an awesome rushing attack. On their second series of downs, Stanford goes to work with Don Bunce firing to tight end Bill Scott for 12 yards. Bunce then hits flanker John Winesbury for 19 more and moves into Michigan territory. But a field goal attempt of 52 yards by Rod Garcia falls short. The Stanford defense proves it's going to be tough to deal with as it stymies the mighty Michigan running game. And cornerback Benny Barnes sets up another scoring opportunity with this interception of a Tom Slade aerial. Garcia this time tries a 55-yard field goal that is short of its mark, and the game remains scoreless. Michigan's fearsome offense begins to move with number 42 Billy Taylor struggling for a first down. Slade scrambles. And then in the second quarter, marches Michigan into Stanford territory before the Indians' defense stalls the attack. But it's still close enough for Dana Coyne's 30-yard field goal that gives Michigan a 3-0 lead. The half ends, and head coach John Ralston and his Stanford Indians have some catching up to do. Michigan wastes little time getting its offense moving, but Stanford's Thunder Chickens, with Pete Lazatich and Larry Butler leading the way, put up a magnificent goal line stand. Bunce has to work out of his own end zone. The Stanford quarterback does it like magic, first hitting Brown for 8 yards, then firing to Sanderson, who breaks loose for 19 more. Winesbury is on the receiving end of a Bunce pass at the Michigan 25-yard line, where Garcia makes good on his third field goal attempt from 42 yards out, tying the score at 3-3. Michigan battles back early in the fourth quarter. Glenn Doughty batters his way for a first down. And then Slade fires a completion to Doughty, who's stopped at the Stanford goal line. From there, fullback Fritz Seifert plows his way in for the score, and the Wolverines move back in front 10-3. Bunce, though, goes back to work. His third down pass, incomplete. And then John Ralston works his magic, punt formation, but fake the snap short to Jim Cale, who passes the ball between his legs to Jackie Brown. Downfield, 31 yards, and Stanford has new life at the Michigan 36-yard line. Five plays later, Brown bursts through a hole at right tackle, cleared by Bill Myers and younger Clifford, and romps into the end zone. The Indians have tied it 10-10, and the capacity crowd roars its approval. The excitement is short-lived, though. Disaster strikes later in the quarter when a field goal attempt by Michigan's Coin falls short. Stanford's James Ferguson, with a signal to go, attempts to run it out. He's thrown into the end zone by the Wolverines' Ed Shuttlesworth, and Michigan gets 2 points. Stanford trails 12-10, 3 minutes left in the battle. But the Indians' defense stops the Wolverines, Michigan forced to kick, and Eric Cross returns to the Stanford 22-yard line, 1:48 remaining. Bunce's spectacular, hitting Scott for 10 yards. Then Winesbury on a great catch for 16 more. Two plays later, he fires a strike to Miles Moore for 11 yards. His fifth completion in the last 6 tries finds Winesbury in the open for a 12-yard gain at the Michigan 29. Brown plows into the line to position the ball, and a mere 16 seconds remain as a hush falls over the capacity crowd. The smallest man on the field, 5'9", Rod Garcia, puts his right foot into the ball from the 21-yard line, and Stanford has scored its second straight Rose Bowl upset, an incredible 13-12 victory over Michigan and the Big Ten. A brilliant finish to Pacific 8 football 1971. Happy motoring as you drive to the games with Humble.